Cape Law, Unit 2, Module 1, Tort Law. Today we'll be doing liability for animals. So there are four different ways in which a defendant may be liable for damage done by his animal. And these four ways may be classified as A, liability for cattle trespass, B, liability for dangerous animals, C, liability for dogs, and D, liability in negligence. In addition to these main heads of liability for animals, a person may incur tortious liability through the instrumentality of his animals under the ordinary law of torts. So for example, someone who keeps pigs or goats may be liable for private nuisance if the stench from his animals unreasonably interfere with his neighbor's enjoyment of his land, for example. Or somebody who deliberately sets his dog or releases his dog upon another person may be liable for battery, just like if he had thrown a stone or hit the person. And in some cases, it may even be possible for someone who trains his parrot to defame someone could be liable for slander. And so just have to remember that ordinary law of torts often apply to all torts. So, liability for cattle trespass. So at common law, where cattle are either intentionally driven onto the claimant's land or stray there, the owner or person in whose possession they are in strict liable, is strictly liable for all damage done by them. So cattle at common law, the definition would include cows and bulls, but also horses, donkeys, sheep, pigs, goats, and sometimes even poultry. Right, damages under this head, cattle trespass, are recoverable not only for harm caused to the claimant's land and crops by the trespass, but also for injury to his animals and chattels, and for any injuries inflicted on the claimant himself. So there's this case, East Coast Estates Limited and Sing. And in this case, cattle belonging to the defendant had strayed onto the plaintiff's land and damaged the grass, the special grass which the plaintiffs were cultivating. It was called Pangola grass. And the defendant alleged that as he was driving his cattle along the road, rain began to fall and he was forced to drive the cattle into a nearby space where, through no fault of his own, they strayed onto the plaintiff's land. And in this case, the court held that liability in cattle trespass is strict, and the defendant was liable whether or not he had any intention or whether or not he was negligent. And strict liability at common law in relation to the tort of cattle trespass has been amended by statute in most West Indian countries, but not in Trinidad and Tobago. The result now is that only where the cattle trespass has been committed by either a bull, cow, ox, a heifer, calf, and it was committed to a small holding, for example, a parcel of cultivated land or pasture, then there's strict liability. So therefore, the result is that if goats or sheep do damage to another person's garden, the claimant does not have the advantage of strict liability in cattle trespass, but will have to show negligence. So the defense for cattle trespass, generally, it is a defense to show that the animal strayed from the highway where they're being driven without negligence on the part of the persons bringing them there. So the rationale behind this rule is that the owner of the land that is next to or abutting the public road who does not want animals to enter his premises should fence them. Otherwise, he is deemed to have consented to run the risk of the dangers incident to the ordinary and non-negligent use of the highway. There are also other defenses such as voluntary non-fit injury, which I believe we touched on before. The claimant's own default in failing to perform his own duty, and also an act of God. So parties to an action in cattle trespass They can only sue a person with an only a person sorry with an interest in the land could sue. So you can't sue on behalf of somebody else, or if you don't own the property, you don't have an interest in the property, and the cattle trespass on it, you can't sue. You need to have an interest in the property, and this was stated in the case of Aziz and Singh. So the second classification, dangerous animals. So there's liability in tort for injury or damage done by a dangerous animal kept by someone. The common law classifies animals into two categories. A, animals feroe natura, that is, those belonging to a naturally wild or dangerous species, such as lions, tigers, gorillas, bears, and elephants. And B, animals mansuate natura, that is, those belonging to a naturally tame, harmless, and in most cases domesticated species, such as horses, donkeys, cows, sheep, goats, cats, and dogs. The owner or keeper of an animal feroe natura is strictly liable for any harm which it causes. It is irrelevant whether or not the particular animal has shown a propensity for that kind of harm or harm in the past. So in the case of Behrens and Bertram Mill Circus, it was held that the owner or keeper of an animal feroe natura is strictly liable for any harm which it causes. It is irrelevant whether or not the particular animal has shown propensity for that kind of harm in the past, or that the accident occurred due to the circumstances beyond their control. However, the owner or keeper of an animal mansuate natura is liable for harm caused by the animal only if A, that particular animal has shown a propensity in the past to do harm of that kind, and B, the owner or keeper of it is proved to have had knowledge of such propensity. So proof of knowledge of the animal's vicious propensity, the onus of which is on the claimant, which is important to note, this is called scienter. And this is derived from the Latin word for knowledge. And the tort originally involved proof that the defendant knowingly kept a dangerous animal. Such a case is called a scienter action. And the following principles govern liability under a scienter action. So, firstly, the judge must decide whether the animal in question is to be classified as feroe natura or mansuate natura on the basis of judicial notice or on expert evidence. The court takes judicial notice of well-known everyday facts, such as that the sun rises in the east, and evidence is not required to be produced for such matters. Secondly, the court must be satisfied that the damage done was of the same class that the previous knowledge related to. So if a dog attacks a man, for example, it must be shown that the animal had the propensity to attack humans. It would not be sufficient to show a propensity to attack other animals. And thirdly, it is not necessary to show that the animal had actually done the particular type of damage on a previous occasion. It is sufficient to prove that it had exhibited a tendency to do that kind of harm. If the claimant can show that the animal did, on a previous occasion, actually cause the particular type of harm, then his case will be stronger. Fourthly, knowledge of an animal's vicious propensity will be imputed to a defendant where it is acquired by someone to whom the defendant delegated full custody or control of the animal. So other persons, such as a spouse or a keeper or a servant in charge of the premises where the animal is kept will be presumed to have communicated the knowledge to the keeper. Fifthly, for the purpose of a science or action, it is immaterial where the animal's attack took place. So whether it's on the claimant's land or the defendant's land or the land of a third party or the highway in a public place, it doesn't matter. And this was from the case of Aziz and Singh. Now you would notice that this is contrary to, or not contrary, but different from the rules governing cattle trespass, where in order to bring a claim, you need to have an interest in the land. That's not the case here. Wherever it happens, the defendant could still be held liable. Well, it is also important to note that in the case that harm is caused by an animal, mans utile natura, the propensity of the animal must be shown to be vicious or hostile. So the defendant will not be liable if the animal was merely indulging in a propensity towards playfulness or some other non-aggressive behavior, especially where such a propensity is common to most animals of that species, such as the frolicking of spirited horses or dogs chasing each other or running across traffic. So in the case of McIntosh and McIntosh, the plaintiff was riding his female donkey along a track when the defendant's male donkey jumped onto the track and attempted to service the female donkey, and in doing this caused injuries to both the plaintiff and the female donkey. And there was evidence to show that on a previous occasion, the male donkey had attempted to do this with the female donkey, and while it was lying down somewhere, and the defendant knew about this. But the court held that the defendant was not liable since the male donkey, in attempting to service the female donkey, was just displaying a natural propensity. It's part of its nature. So, parties under scienter. So, liability under the scienter action rests on the person who harbors and controls the animal. So, in most cases, this would be the owner, but not necessarily so. So, when an occupier of premises takes care of a vicious dog left on the premises by a previous tenant, for example, he will be held liable for injuries caused by the animal. The mere fact that an occupier has tolerated someone else's animal visiting his land, however, does not fix him with the responsibility for its mischief. So, in the case of Norton Wood, where an 11-year-old girl owned and fed a dog which inflicted injury on the plaintiff sued the girl's father and was held that the father was not liable. And the court went on to state that the mere fact that an occupier tolerates the presence of someone else's animal on his land does not fix him with the responsibility for its mischief. It is also important to note that it is not a defense to keep an animal with the deliberate intention of injuring rather than merely deterring trespassers. And this is because a defendant has no right to put an animal in such a situation that a person innocently coming for a lawful purpose may be injured by it. It is important to note, however, that if a claimant is entirely responsible for his injuries, his action will fail altogether. If he was merely contributory negligent, his damages would be reduced based on the amount or the ratio of his contribution to his own injury. And the defense of voluntary non-fit injuria will often apply where persons whose livelihood it is to deal with dangerous animals, such as zookeepers and animal traders, are injured in the course of their work. They are presumed to have accepted this possible danger. So now we're going on to liability for dogs. And the owner or an owner is liable at common law for damage done by his dog if he has had knowledge of its dangerous disposition. So for example, if it is a naturally dangerous breed, such as like a pit bull or a Rottweiler, or it has in the past shown a vicious disposition. Dogs are treated as a special type of animal mansurate natura. And the reason for this is firstly that many people keep dogs and that the dog population is very high. Also, dogs are kept for a variety of purposes as pets, guard dogs, or hunters. And thirdly, they are notoriously energetic and difficult to keep under restraint, and they are prone to stray. Also, dogs are not within the definition of cattle at common law, so that a defendant cannot be liable in cattle trespass for damage caused by his dog straying onto the claimant's land. It is important to note, however, that in various Commonwealth Caribbean countries, legislation has been passed to provide for forms of strict liability for harm caused by dogs. So in Trinidad and Tobago, for example, there's the Dangerous Dogs Act. So now liability in negligence, which is the final of the four heads, in which an owner of an animal may be liable for damage done under the common law. So, quite apart from any liability in cattle trespass or under the Santa rule, the keeper of an animal owes a duty to take care that it does not become a source of harm to others. If an action in cattle trespass or under the Santa rule does not succeed, one in negligence may. So in the case of Draper and Hodder, the plaintiff, who was an infant, was attacked and badly injured by a pack of terrier dogs, which suddenly dashed out of the defendant's premises. It was held that the plaintiff could not recover in cattle trespass because dogs are not included within the definition of cattle. He also could not recover under the Scienter rule because he could not prove that the defendant had any knowledge of a vicious propensity on the part of any particular dog. He did succeed in negligence, however, on the ground that the defendant knew ought to have known that Jack Russell Terriers could be dangerous if allowed to roam in packs, yet he had taken no steps to fence them in or otherwise to prevent them from escaping and doing damage. Also, in the case of Coley and James, the defendant's servant brought a cow onto a busy highway and negligently left it unattended so that it trotted off home, and in the course of doing so, collided with and damaged the plaintiff's car. And the defendant was held liable for negligence in this case. And finally, we're going to talk about the limits to liability in negligence. So, it must be proved that a duty of care was owed by the defendant to the claimant because A, there was a special risk of injury to others, and B, that the defendant was aware of the possibility of the particular kind of injury occurring. If, for example, a horse bit a human, it would not be sufficient to show that the horse was high-spirited and therefore likely to knock people down. Harm from a bite is a totally different kind of harm from accidental collision. It would be necessary to show that the defendant's horse had previously tried to bite someone and that the defendant knew of the previous incident. An important exclusion from liability for negligence is the rule that was held in Searle and Walbank, and this rule states that the occupier of premises adjoining a highway is under no duty to users of the highway to prevent his domestic animals, not known to be dangerous, from straying onto the highway and causing accidents there. At common law, there is no duty upon the owner of the land to maintain a fence or other obstacle around the property to keep his animals in. And that's it for the topic of liability for animals. Like and subscribe, and I'll be releasing some new videos very soon.